September 8th school committee meeting to order. We're going to start off with questions, comments from the public. Seeing none today, we're going to move on to the Director of Finance, where she will start off with the FY21 financials as of June 30th for a discussion and vote.
Okay. In the packet, there were four documents that outlined where we ended up and the actions that need to be taken. So the first one is the 9-page line-by-line budget. And what I did was I color-coded it, so the two budget transfers that are necessary, the ones that are in yellow are the ones that the Director of Finance has the ability to transfer from like major function code to major, within the same function code. The ones that are in green are the ones that the school committee will have to vote because they're transfers that happen outside of the major function codes. I think just bottom line, unless anybody had any specific questions, we ended up with a unencumbered and unexpended balance of $980,000, which is 2.23% of our total budget.
So we had just discussed this at BNF, but is anyone of the school committee members here have any questions regarding the... Yes, Jeff.
So is that 980,000, that's for last fiscal year?
That's yes, that's how FY21 ended.
And that would roll into E&D?
Correct.
Okay. And what would be the, I know it's not certified, but what's the estimated E&D balance with that?
It will be around $1.2 million. Which this current year it was certified at 1.6. We used 800,000 to balance the budget, and then we added back about 400,000 in revenues and unexpended expenditures, because some of the revenues were short.
So not quite our 3%. Any other questions? School committee? No? Okay. I would entertain a motion to approve the FY21 financials as of June 30th, 2021.
So moved.
Second. Any discussion on this? Seeing none, all those in favor? Okay. Up next is the recommended year-end budget transfers.
So in the budget transfer sheet that is color-coded green, you will see the most of the accounts that went way over are because of COVID. They have been noted in every quarterly report that I gave as they were going over. So what this would do is take these major accounts, which include teacher salaries, therapeutic contract services, teacher substitutes, electricity, and electricity is mainly due to where we fixed all of the HVAC systems. It takes more electricity to run everything that runs. So that was unexpected, and you'll see that every school is over on their electricity. And then the accounts that are on the left are the accounts that we had savings in. Again, those were noted in my quarterly reports where I thought they were going to end. There's basically six big accounts that we were able to save money. I'm gonna skip the first one because it's contingency and we'll come back to that. We have a salaries holding account, and what that account is when we were budgeting for FY22 salaries, we were still in negotiations with three units. So there was some estimates there, and also as positions, people resigned and they were filled with a less expensive person, I put the savings in this account. So if it ever came up that we had to hire someone, I would know how much excess salaries that we had that I would have to fund that position. Lane changes, I think due to COVID, people didn't take classes. as they had anticipated, so we didn't have as much lane movement. Lane movement is like with their like masters to master study and whatnot. The third big account was in transportation. This is regular transportation. That savings came about through a favorable contract renewal, as well as the kids didn't come on Fridays. They were remote on Fridays for most of the year. That same would be true with special ed transportation. There's $120,000 savings there. And then we had $170,000 savings in custodial contract services because we had let the company go and hired a new company, and they are less expensive. So that leaves the last big expense line would be educational contingency. We had $320,000 in that line this year, so I would recommend that we use $204,000 of that to balance the overages due to COVID.
Okay. Any questions, school committee members? Seeing none, I just want to mention something that I mentioned at the BNF meeting. The change in some of the teacher salaries, the increases in the staff salaries, and expenditures for COVID, we didn't expect to be getting more students coming in full-time in April, so that did cost some additional expenses for the safety precautions. And as Sherry mentioned, with the savings from negotiations, contracts for vendors and employees helped offset some of that cost, so well done, Sherry.
Yeah. Can we put it up there?
Yeah, we should be able to.
Do you have these?
If we share it with Kristen, maybe.
And I can put it on the web tomorrow.
And it should be on the business and finance webpage as well. All of these forms start with archives and to current. So if you want to see anything moving forward too, that's where you can get it.
Yeah, and it was placed there prior to the meeting, so you could have seen it if you were not aware. But I'm just saying that you could have seen it.
Oh, it's easier to just print. Then that's going to be difficult to see as well. But
it's easier to see it while talking about it.
Yes, absolutely, right. Absolutely. Sherry, we were at a point of the recommendation.
I'm sorry. Did you want to see this sheet? Kristen is wondering if she's putting it up or not.
If she has access to it.
Do you want me to put it up?
Yeah, we can put it up.
Thank you.
While we're waiting for that, though, I'm going to take another agenda item out of order. I would entertain a motion to vote to approve the meeting minutes of August 25th.
So moved.
Second.
Yes.
No.
Oh. Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor?
I'm going to abstain. I wasn't here.
Okay. We have liaison and subcommittee updates. Does any school committee members have any updates? I know it's early in the year.
Just a couple. I reached out to all three boards of Dunstable, Selectmen, Health, and Advisory, and notified them of our changes. They're all pleased and welcome the changes. So that's that. In terms of the legislature, I did speak to the senator's chief of staff today and the state representative, both wishing the district, everyone, students, administrators, and staff have a good reopening. And anything that's coming down the line that pertains to our district, we'll be in contact. Other than that, I think that's pretty much it.
Okay.
I think it's up.
Okay.
That's the problem, is that it's very difficult to read up there.
Well, there's an effort. Basically, the bottom level is where the savings are. I know the numbers are tough to see. Those are what help offset the higher part, which, again, easier to be on the actual document website. But while it is up there, first of all, does any, I think we're at a point, did I get to a discussion? I don't think so.
Yeah, you're asked if there's
any. Yeah. Any discussions on the transfers? Okay, all those in favor of recommending the year-end transfers as presented by the Business and Finance Director? Okay.
Yeah, did we have a motion on that yet?
I thought we had a motion. Let's do it again.
Okay.
No,
I'd entertain a motion to recommend the year-end budget transfers as recommended by the Business and Finance Director.
Second.
All right, now discussion. None. All those in favor? Okay.
Sorry. Actually, I think we need to do a roll call for the financial.
For finance?
Yeah.
We'll start at the end. Ralph?
Yes.
Jeff?
Yes.
Lacey?
Yes.
Marlena, yes. Faye?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And before we move on, I know that we were jumping around here. So that's all for the financials, except for the warrant articles. We'll come back to that. I don't think Sherry's,
no, she's
you're not needed for the warrant articles. So if you'd like to go home,
okay,
you're more than welcome to. But okay. Under liaison updates, I also wanted it to introduce our new liaison to the CPAC. Let me try and swing this way. So if you could introduce yourself to the community.
Hi, my name is Kristen McInnes, and I have a daughter in the third grade over at Flow Row, and I am happy to be part of this team. I look forward to working with y'all. Thank you.
Very good. Welcome. Okay. Any other liaison reports to share? Yes, Rafi.
It's not for me, actually. Well, it's not a report from me, but I unfortunately wished our colleague was here so I could ask again for another report on the DEI subcommittee. I know I asked, I believe, a month after it was formed, and they were still forming. So now it's 3 months, so I wonder if there's been any progress. So I would ask the chair that she might reach out or just deliver some sort of, I don't know, report. Because I, unlike the rest of the district, am very curious to know. So thank you.
A report was provided. They actually had their organizational meeting. Their meetings start up at the end of September, but they're on the district website for anyone who wants to attend those meetings. And they are public meetings, so you are able to attend, listen in, and they start in September, including you, Rafi, if you wanted to attend, you can do that as well. They're on the district website off the top of my head. I believe it's the last week of September, last full week of September. And they'll be on a regular schedule, all in there. And actually, I believe there's an option where you can get notified for all public meetings on your phone now, which is really convenient.
Right. There's an app that we have that's associated with the website. So if you want to have a district meeting blast get sent to you, you can just select the district along with your student school. And then anytime we have a notification push, it will get pushed. We pushed school committee's notification a couple days ago.
I think you meant the last week of August, right?
Since what? Okay.
You said September, but you meant last week of August they met?
They met once.
They met only once for organization, and then their regular set meetings, I thought, were the end of September, but I could be wrong. Maybe it is October. I know that there was a scheduling, obviously getting everyone present. It's a large committee, and like any other large committee that I've ran, if you have 10, 15 people, getting everyone together is a, it's like, squirreling cats together. It's an interesting concept. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. And during the summer, you're very difficult to get people together in that. But it is happening, and it's the schedule. And if you want to know when you want to attend meetings, the best place is the district website, especially now that we have a new website. Lastly, the liaison for select board, an update for the Groton Select Board. They did vote to share their CARES Act money with the district to help us with COVID expenses for this year. $900,000 is the number that they were looking at having us utilize, which will help us immensely in regards to this budget because we do have COVID expenses that were accounted for in this budget, and hoping that the CARES Act money would help fund that. Dunstable's still working on that in regards to their participation. Lastly, the Council on Aging, we have a new director, in which I'm planning on introducing to myself, if I can get in this week, if not next week. And then we'll start attending their meetings now that the summer has concluded, and with regular updates as that as well. And I think that's all for liaison updates, unless anyone else? No? Okay. All right, COVID updates.
So before I start, I'll say that I am actually going to be going to the Council on Aging to discuss some of their questions regarding our curricula in the third week in September. So if we can go to the next slide, Kristen, see if our technology is actually going to be working.
Oh, that's two, right?
Hold on. That's two.
There you go.
We're going to talk about vaccination rates. Again, an update, positive cases in the last 14 days for the towns, and then I'm going to talk about cases actually for the district. And then Kristen's going to give us a little bit of an update on curriculum instruction and assessment. So in terms of the vaccination rates, next slide. Yep, that's it. Thank you. Oh, no, the one before that. There we go. So this is the data, the last data. It says August 26th, I think it was actually, might have been slightly after that, but it's the last Thursday's data that comes directly from the Massachusetts Department of Public Health. Some people have asked us where we get this information, and you can get it on Thursday evenings. It's released in the Massachusetts Department of Public Health. All you have to do is to Google Massachusetts vaccination rates by municipality, that's where this information comes from. So from 12 to 15 year olds, we continue to see a very slow increase, but we are seeing an increase in Groton. And again, this comes by municipality, so that's how the only way we're able to get the data at this time. 16 to 19 year olds have plateaued, but they're at greater than 95%, so they really didn't have a lot of ways to go. And Groton as a community, 68% fully vaccinated, 74% partially vaccinated. That's actually plateaued in the last 2 weeks. In Dunstable, for our 12 to 15 year olds, again, we've seen no movement over the last, or it's plateaued over the last couple weeks, 41% fully vaccinated, 53% partially vaccinated. In our 16 to 19 year olds, also a plateau, 62% fully vaccinated, 65% partially vaccinated. And in Dunstable overall as a community, 63% fully vaccinated and 67% partially vaccinated. The next slide, please. So the school committee had a target of 90% that they were looking for. And so we do a weighted average based on how many students are from Groton and how many students are from Dunstable in each age group. So there are 904 students total across the district in ages 12 to 15. And right now about 64% of those students are vaccinated. And at 16 to 19, we have about 893 students across the district and across both towns, I should say, because some of those students don't attend our schools, and that's at the 87%, but very little has changed from the previous week. Next slide. I went over this just a minute ago, but basically we are not seeing a lot of change over the last couple weeks. The DESE policy requires us to remain as we are for at least until 10-1. And then the school committee policy indicates that we have to consult with the local board of health and the pediatrician before proposing any changing. Let's go to the next slide, please. So if we look at our 14-day average daily incident rate over time, you'll see what the daily average rate is from both towns from 7:15 up to 9:02. You'll see that we've had a significant increase in Dunstable over the last 2 weeks, and Groton is actually sort of starting to trend downward. Next slide, please. So now we have students have come back to school, and I will start reporting on a weekly basis the positive tests for COVID 19 that are within our schools and both the staff and the students. We had one positive case at Butwell. We had two positive cases at Florence Roach. We had one positive case at Swallow. On students in at the middle school, there were two positive cases with the staff and two positive cases with students. And at the high school, there was one positive case with students. And then I'll be starting next week, the numbers will change for the cumulative. They're the same numbers because this was the only week that we had collected this data. In our contact tracing, similar to last year, we are not finding that any of these students in our contact tracing have received the infection through school. The vast majority of these are directly attributable to parents within or adults within the home or a sibling within the home. Next slide, please. So we're doing pool testing now. We're also doing test and stay. So we have approximately 1,300 students and staff that have signed up for pool testing. Yesterday we did the middle school and the high school and we completed our results. We got our results within 8 hours and there were no confirmed positives. The testing of the elementary school was completed today and we should receive the results by tomorrow morning. We have about 40 staff and students that are involved in test and stay, and that is when a staff member or student is identified as a close contact to someone in the schools that has tested positive for COVID. And the state regulations suggest, or guidance that we have from the state says that we can use what's called a Binex Now rapid test, which comes back in 15 minutes. And will tell us whether that student or staff member is in fact positive or still remains negative. And this is only done on also on close contacts that are asymptomatic. And so we've been using that quite successfully. After 7 days have passed from when that student or staff member was identified as a close contact, provided they're continuing to have negative tests, and that's what's been happening thus far, we conclude the testing and we don't have to continue to test. But there's been some concerns actually that have been raised about what the pool testing looks like. So we're gonna have a little demonstration now. Kristen has very graciously
volunteered.
Well, she might have been voluntold. But anyway, so some people are under the impression that the Q-tip that's used by the students and in grades 3 and up, this is done by the students. Maybe we'll get a close-up, maybe we won't, we'll have to see, has some chemical on it. It is actually a Q-tip that is completely sterile and in a packet. There is nothing on it. It is a Q-tip. It's a stick with a little bit of fuzz on the end. So what happens is we actually cut open the ends for the student and then they pull the thing out. I did not cut students Kristen's end because I wanted you to see it was a sealed tube.
I'm not sure how much of this you can see. Are you zooming in pretty closely?
Okay.
So it just peels apart like this. The Q-tip end stays inside of the sterile plastic where it comes.
Right.
And then the
student. And we hand it to the student.
We'll go like this. And our older students, what's the grade level again?
3.
Grade 3?
Grade 3, yeah.
All you have to do is just do a little swab.
Just like you're sticking a Q-tip in your ear.
And then
they put it, and there's nothing in that tube. It is completely empty. And we put anywhere from 7, 8, 9, 10 students put their Q-tip in there. We seal it up and we put it in the rack and then it goes off to the Broad Laboratory in Cambridge. So I wanted to make sure, I had talked to a mom this morning that was under the impression that there was some kind of chemical on the end of that Q-tip. And I want to make sure that people see from this demonstration that it's a Q-tip, the same kind of Q-tip, except it's in a sterile case, so because we want it to be not be contaminated. But it's the same kind of Q-tip that you can purchase at the CVS.
Kristen, can you pass that down?
Sure. I sure can. I've closed
this is show
it,
and
so.
Tell.
Absolutely.
You have to ask the chair if you can ask a question.
I'm sorry.
She wants to ask a question.
Yes.
Yes. Oh, that's a good question. Thank you very much. So what happens is we have lists in the district So everybody that's in the same homeroom generally is about in the same, can I just see that for one second? Everybody that's in the same homeroom that's consented, their parents have consented them to be tested, goes into the same thing, and we have a list. So, and then we have a code, say, so I'm going to use my name. I don't have a homeroom, but whatever. So C for Chesson, fifth for fifth grade, and then my room number is my code. And then there is a label that's printed, and it goes on the end of this tube. And then the only thing the lab gets is this barcode. So the lab would say to us, they would send me an email, and I got some, that to tell me that there were a couple things where kids, if kids put it in upside down, we had to retest today two tubes because kids put it in upside down as opposed to right side up. So it has the barcode number, and then it has the label number that's on the bottom, and then we go back to the list, and that's how we know.
Individually.
So individually. Yeah. So that's the second part of that, is that if, as long as the procedure was followed properly, because we, as I said, we had two today where they said to us, we can't test this because one of the things is in the wrong way. And we just re-pooled those kids. But if a pool was to come back positive, then we use the Binex Now rapid test, which is even more sensitive than the method that they use at the Broad, and we test all of those students, and provided they test negative, they go on to class, and if someone tests positive, we would contact their parents. Thanks, you. Great questions. Thank you.
Did it make its way all the way down there? No. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. So how often
I'll leave it
do you test the test and stay group? Is it every day for the 7 days?
Yes, the test and stay. If you're in a test,
we can't. We didn't hear the question.
The question was, how often do we test the test and stay groups? So those students are tested for 7 days in a row. If a weekend happens in the middle of that, we offer the students to take home a take home test, and they're welcome to. Their parents are welcome to administer that test at home. We have take home tests for students, and some parent and you test and stay is totally optional. So if you want to have your child quarantine for 10 days, you can do that, or you can do test and stay, and they can stay at school. And thus far, we have, as I said, we have about 40 people that are in test and stay right now, and none of them have ever tested positive. And some of them are on day 7.
Any other questions?
Oh, sorry, Faye.
Also, it says
swing
over,
the microphone.
Sorry, over 1,300 students have signed up. Students and staff have signed up out of a total number of
about 2,500.
Okay. All right.
Okay. So we're just going to go quickly over some fall reopening items.
I'm sorry.
Oh, go ahead. I'm sorry. I didn't realize
so
your question.
I'm sorry. That's okay. I had asked this last time, but just about the vaccination measurements. So you're using the state data right now.
Right.
Which is kind of a rough estimate.
Right.
But I guess, do you have a plan in place to collect vaccination records? And they'll be kept private, I'm sure. But
yes, they get put in the students' health records in the office, just okay. The same as any other vaccination rate.
Is there anything in terms of, should parents be sending those records in now, or are you going to ask for those at a later date?
They're welcome to send it in now if it's that's convenient for them. For example, if they take their student to get vaccinated and they want to send us a copy of the card, they can do that. But that can be sent to the school nurse at each school. But right now we're concentrating on getting our testing program up. So there's only so much bandwidth that the nurses have right now. And
we can't do anything until October
1st. And because we're so far from the 12 to 15-year-olds, I mean, it looks like the 16 to 19-year-olds, but there's not even a school that would cover because we have to get the high school up. So when we get done with the testing, when we get it down so that it becomes a regular thing, probably about in a month, and we get past the October date, we'll really start requesting, just like we requested our staff. So all our staff that's been vaccinated were asked to bring in a copy of their vaccination certificate, which was placed in their personnel file, which is kept locked and confidential. And that the reason we did that is because right now, if you do not have a vaccination certificate on file, then you must wear a mask all the time, even if you're not in the presence of children or in the presence of anyone else. So from the time you enter the building to the time you leave, unless you're outside or you're eating. So, and the staff has been very cooperative. We're in a good place. We're like, I know, I think about 90% of the staff have already turned those in.
I have one last question.
Okay.
Sorry.
So
are we looking at some sort of mechanisms to see if we can encourage more people to participate in testing? Because it really is the most effective tool that we have to keep control of this. I know it's been advertised at the beginning of the year. There's a waiver that needs to be signed, and every once in a while there's a line at the end of the newsletter or the notification. I'm wondering if there's any other way that we can possibly encourage people or higher numbers to participate in it. So, because when we're doing the test and stay, if that person is not part of, hasn't signed a release for testing, then even in that test and stay scenario, they're not able to, they won't test, right?
There are some limited occasions where people have signed a release for just test and stay, okay, and not pool testing. However, I like your point. I want to emphasize that to parents that the best thing, one of the best things that we can do is to have people participate in the testing. And that's one of the reasons why I wanted to have Kristen show tonight. And I thank her for that, because she certainly, we don't ask students to do it on camera, let's put it that way. So it's not the most comfortable thing to want to do on camera. It's totally painless. It's just like sticking a Q-tip in your ear. But and as I've said to another parent, and 6-year-olds are often known to stick things up inside their nose, way higher than that Q-tip goes. I think there was some concerns by some folks. There was some information that was not correct, that there were chemicals involved and students were being exposed to chemicals. And I'm hoping that by this demonstration and by putting that on the agenda this evening, that will help. I would have to check with my school nurses. I will agree that I know a lot, but the school nurses more than I. So I'm uncomfortable answering that question, but you know what? I'm going to get the answer and I'll let you know. I need to talk to the school nurses. Right. There are medical people, and I feel like it's really better to get it from someone who's got the experience than I. But great question.
When the update, which you email on a regular basis, comes out, that information can be added to that information, so you'll have it then.
Yeah, so when I send out this tomorrow to all the parents, I will include that information after I get it from a medical professional. Okay.
Did you have one more?
No, not yet.
Okay.
All right,
so fall reopening items, just very briefly, arrival and dismissal actually has been going pretty well. We're a little bit behind where I'd like to be at the elementary schools. It's taking about 5 minutes longer than we'd like, and we're going to be working on that. I do want to remind parents that since this Friday is a non-early release Friday, right? I am correct that the elementary schools will be beginning dismissal at 3:10. Many people will not experience any change in what time their child arrives home at all, because we can only get so many buses and so many students out the door at the same time. So we're beginning, right now we begin at 3:20 and we'll actually begin at 3:10. So there are some buses there's one bus that we noticed has been sitting in front of Florence Roach at 2:40 in the afternoon, waiting to take their elementary school students home, but that's not the case in all of them. I want to thank everyone who participated in and signed up ahead of time for our athletes and our athletic staff in terms of our pool testing, also known as regular COVID safety checks. We did send home a paper copy of the consent last night as a last-ditch effort to get as many students as possible. It's my understanding that everybody accepts for 6 students, and those students just forgot to give their paper to their parents. So if they bring it back signed, as soon as they bring it back signed, they're allowed back into practice, and we will start testing them next week. Buses, we've talked about over and over again. I do see that the buses are fuller this year than they have been in the past, and that's a good sign. We have reiterated with the bus company that the windows need to stay open in order to get good air circulation. Parents got a whole document on test and stay and on contact tracing. And lunch, I want to emphasize that although we do have free lunch for all, that if you are thinking that your family might be eligible for free and reduced lunch, it actually affects what funding we get from the federal government and from the state government. So we would highly recommend that folks fill that out if they even think that they might be eligible for that, even though that lunch is free to everybody this year. Next slide.
Excuse me?
Yes. Yeah, so that form comes from CIC Health. We had no control over that form. It is not optional for athletics. It is optional. That form was designed so that for 2,000 schools in the state of Massachusetts, and in some schools, that form was automatically sent home to every single student, and only those students that filled out the opt-out were not going to be tested. So a lot of those schools would be charter schools and parochial schools that have the ability to mandate that every student get tested. So I apologize for the confusion with that document, but we had no control over the information that was given in that document. We were not allowed to come up with our own document as we were able to do last year, and that's why that information is on there. And that is why the athletic director and I have made every effort to answer every single email that has been sent to us with that confusion. And I apologize for the confusion, but I was not allowed to edit that document. I totally agree with you, believe me. No. No. That's correct. Yes, I understand that.
So I would like the public to know that there should have been more details sent home, or at least that was very deceiving, that letter.
Well, but we sent multiple emails home saying that,
so
I understand.
3 weeks, it went from optional to required to mandate. It was forced on me today. Within 2 hours, I had no one to contact, and my daughter was left there to have to run with a mask on in 83 degree weather, crying to me, just get me tested.
Right, I hear your concern. We had a long conversation about that this morning.
Am I the only one who thinks this in a whole school of 2,500 people?
I had 2 other parents that talked to me, and after I explained why, and as I said to you,
I'm going to ask you to make an appointment to see Dr. Chesson in regards to it, to discuss it about your specific student, so that way we can, and trust me, it pains me to have to follow some of the policies that we have here in the district, but that's my job to enforce them. So if you could please make an appointment with Dr. Chesson, if you've already, you know, escalated that way you can get some resolution in regards to that challenge. Right. And that goes for anyone else who has a problem in regards to any sort of policy, restriction, anything that you have going on with your specific students, please escalate it. And that way we can try and get some resolution for you. Okay, and I also want to, if I could, I've been being flexible in regards to our agenda here. I just want to make sure that everyone has proper expectations of our meetings. Because I think that without proper expectations, that's when you get frustrated, that's when you get the confusion. We have the public comment in the beginning where you can ask any questions or make your comments. when I have time, because we have a smaller agenda tonight, then I'm stopping and I'm able to actually participate, have you answered the questions that you have at that time. When you see a longer agenda, that is when you see I am unable to entertain every single question during the course of this agenda, because it is a business meeting. It's not a public forum. It's not a public forum, and that is why. So if we have a challenge, then I would call a public forum. I just want to set expectations for these meetings that happen twice a month, so that way we can have some sort of structure. So please make the appointment with Dr. Cheston.
Can I finish?
Yes, please finish the presentation.
Okay. So I will go on to test and stay on the next slide. There we go. We've went over that. There's for each day for 5 days, the student or staff, and it says 5 days because sometimes students, it's going to definitely go over a weekend, but we do provide home tests for those who would like to test over the weekend. And one of the reasons we do that is because we may have students that are athletes that were close contacts, and they will be able to test over the weekend. And now I'm going to turn the presentation over to Kristen to talk about curriculum, instruction, and assessment.
Can I honestly just ask one question? How are you wasting
If you don't mind, I'm going to have to continue with the agenda, and seeming that we should have some time, I will then certainly entertain. If you could please just be patient with us.
Thank you. I apologize that I'm going to be turning this way because I don't have my computer in front of me, so I'm going to need to see what the slides are, so that's why I'm turning away. If anyone can't hear me, please do let me know, and I'll make sure I adjust the microphone. One of the things that Dr. Cheston and I wanted to make sure that we were able to do this year and make a shift toward is a report that I would be able to give to talk about curriculum, instruction, and assessment. I did mention this briefly in our last school committee meeting, and the reason we felt like that shift was necessary is because last year it was all hands on deck for all things, and so oftentimes you might have heard me talking about our reentry protocol at the beginning of the year, you might have heard me talking about testing, you might have heard me talking about engagement and motivation in interrupted education. So we wanted to make sure we're making a shift this year so that I could start to talk a little bit more about the specifics in curriculum, instruction, and assessment, so that there feels like there's some transparency. I think, personally, it's difficult to ask you to be a partner in your child's education when you don't have some updates on what's happening in classrooms. So that is our goal here with this report. So we're giving this format a try for the first time tonight, and I will look forward to hearing some feedback about it as we move through a couple of sessions. So three things that I wanted to talk to you about being excited to see. So that's how I will start. I will start talking about those three things in just a moment. I will also talk about where we were, where we are, and where we're going in the three areas of curriculum, instruction, and assessment. I will talk a little bit about defining our role, stakeholder role for our partnerships, and I'll talk about what that stakeholder word means for us in education. And then I'll also talk to you about what you can get curious about at home, and that will make a little bit more sense to you as we get to that slide. So the three things that I'm excited about. I got a chance to move into classrooms at the very beginning of the school year, which is something I certainly missed being able to do last year. And as I think about the way we're communicating our district initiatives, that's something I was very excited to see. Even in those first few days of school, it was easy for me to think about how leaders were challenging the staff, the educators, to be curious about the students that were showing up in front of them. And that can mean a lot of things in a regular year, never mind a year where we're following some interrupted typical learning. So I did see those things from all of our principals, and we're going to talk about some of those at the end of the week when we meet as a group, those tangible things that I was able to see in those buildings. I also visited Swallow Union, and if you've ever walked through the hallways of Swallow Union, certainly a happy place to go to elementary school. And what I was able to see is learners getting to know one another, not just classmates, but also the adults in the building. It's wonderful to be able to walk through a building, and elementary school students never have met me, but will walk right up and say, how do I get to the front office? And I get to look and say, well, I don't know, but we can figure it out together. So really working on those first 4 days of school and making those relationships and thinking about practicing routines. And I also ran some meetings this week at the district level. And we got curious about how we can take have a real focus on common understandings. And what I mean when I say that is, in order for us to be aligned in all of the different learning environments across our school systems, we really do need to have a common place of understanding at the district level. And not only do we need to have a common understanding, but we also need to support leaders as they take that and put it into place in the buildings where they're the educational leadership experts. So those were three things I was really excited about in the first couple days of school. When we're thinking about curriculum, where we were, so we were reminding ourselves before school started that our curriculum in the first 6 weeks of school is about learning routines. It's about starting strong relationships, building with adults and classmates, and using academic content areas to get curious about how students are entering the school year. So that's what we talked about before school started. Where we are right now is we've launched this work through wind blocks, morning meetings at the elementary level, workshop models all throughout the district, activities that will help us get to know our students, goal setting with learners, revisiting growth mindset, and collaborating as we set classroom norms. So those are some of the things that are happening right now in school around this set up for our foundations of really great curriculum work. Where we're going, we'll be using content areas more and more to expand our relationship building as we get to know our students as mathematicians, readers, writers, scientists, artists, musicians. The list goes on. The risk you run when you make a list like this is you leave something out. So I say et cetera because there's lots of different ways we are looking at our learners. And I purposefully call our learners mathematicians, scientists, readers, writers. It's very powerful, and it's different than saying we are going to work with math today. We are going to be learning about science. Placing children in that role is very important. So we'll be making sure as we move forward that we set that expectation. Instruction, where we were. Before school started, we provided copies of the text Power of Our Words. I actually have one here. You might have seen some of the webinars that we did. Those will continue. This will be a common theme, instructional theme this year. This is a tool that we feel, as we're working with teachers, really leads to equitable outcomes for all students. And so you'll hear a lot about Power of Our Words this year. We discussed the text as administrators. We ran three book talks that were recorded for educators and parents. And we started and created a toolkit so that we could add to it throughout the school year. That's where we were, where we are. We're thinking about what we will add to our toolkit based on level. So high school, elementary school, middle school are all going to need different supports as they implement this instructional tool. We're getting curious about the language we already use and what changes are necessary. We are setting small goals to address in the way we use language to motivate and engage learners. And we're making meaning of the text as leaders so that we can support the work in buildings. Too often we move quickly. It's one thing for us at this administrative level to have made meaning of this work. If we don't go slowly enough for others to make meaning of this work, it will become a book I read once. So we're working really hard to make sure that that is not the case. And where we're going with this, we are recording additional book talk sessions, so be looking for those. We are launching a think tank in district for educators to learn together. And we already have several educators who have identified wanting to be a part of that, so that's exciting. And we're also finding entry points for evaluation feedback and how it looks around language. So when we think about our feedback loops, if we don't build this work, this Power of Our Words work, into those feedback loops, again, it runs the risk of becoming a book we read once and not something we're putting into practice. And then finally, assessment. Where we were last year, I'll just remind us that we talked about screeners a lot. and what a screener is and what nationally normed means. We talked a lot about that. We talked about data as a narrative, and it isn't just a narrative that is going to come out of these screeners, but we also have kids bring lots of information to school. How are we capturing all of those data points? We share data throughout the year on math and reading. We got used to looking at what a narrative might look, feel, and sound like. And then we also planned in specific educator time to discuss data. That's where we were. Where we are right now is administering those screeners again in reading, math, and writing. So that's going to give us an idea now. Those screeners were administered all year last year. So we're going to be thinking about what might have resulted from the interrupted learning. And remember, summertime is interrupted learning. That doesn't mean children aren't learning. That just means they're learning differently than they would learn in a classroom. So we always want to think about where kids are re-entering the classroom space. We will take a look at MCAS data, and we're getting curious about what we can really use it for. You know, we know that it is not going to be the same kind of data point that it's been in the past. We're gathering data on where our students are socially, emotionally, and behaviorally. And we're designing data meetings to support meaningful conversations around the data narratives. It's one thing to have the data. It's another thing to talk about the data. It's another thing to design instruction based on the data. So that's where we are now. And where we'll be going, we're getting curious about how we make adjustments to our tier one systems and structures based on the narratives we have. So let me just address tier one for those of you that might not be a familiar word. Tier one is what we've established will work for most of our students. Those structures need to be really strong in order for us to be able to decide if it's not working for a student, what do we do next? If that doesn't work, what do we do after that? We're talking about, as I just said, we're talking about what tier two and tier three interventions might look like. And then we're going to continue to discuss how to have effective data meetings. Talking about data is hard. Supporting what that looks, feels, and sounds like is part of our job so that we don't have data that dies in a spreadsheet. That's not where the story is told. That's not where children's stories live. They live in the narrative, so we need to be thinking about how to unpack that. So that was a peek into curriculum, instruction, and assessment. And I guess what I'll use as an example, if I were to talk to you about the stakeholders for students, all of those things that we just talked about are important. So how do we talk to students about that work that we're doing, whether it be about data or instruction or building relationships? How do we talk with educators about how important that is? What does it look like for leaders as we're making meaning of that? And then how do we communicate with families in a way that is going to help them be partners? And so the example I'll give is one of those ways is talking about power of our words quite a bit so that we can start to have that common language about how powerful language is. Finally, get curious. We've asked all of our faculty members to get curious about what students are bringing to their classrooms. And I'd like to invite you all, and I'll tell you how this will be captured also in writing, but just for this presentation tonight, I'd like to invite all of you to get curious about how these first 6 weeks of school are going for your learner. And some of the ways you might do that is you could get curious about your own language and your family. You know, find what is working, what's your common vocabulary, how are you communicating with one another, what does it look, feel, and sound like, what's successful, what do you find reflecting was not successful. Get curious about what your learner needs for a routine outside of school to support their learning. Our kids are busy. You know, it might be for you that it would be really convenient for them to do their homework right when they come home, but for them it might be convenient or really necessary and imperative for them to take a break and have a snack. So be really thinking about it. Get curious. Ask them. Get curious about what's working for your learner in the classroom. Ask them that question. Where do you feel most successful in your day and how come? Where do you feel really great as a learner and where do you feel like you might have some obstacles you have to get over? They'll tell you. Ask those kinds of questions. What I'd like to do throughout the year through the News Bites newsletter, which we started last year, is give you more ways to get curious. And I'm hoping that that will help our partnership as we work together to build these, you know, really great at-home environments and in-school environments for students to learn.
I think that's it.
Is that my last? Yep, that is my last slide.
So I just want to add that starting once a month, Kristen will be giving you some examples about what we're covering in certain
classroom. So if you're, she'll give, for example, she may say, well, if your child is in sixth grade in math, we are, in this month, we are covering this or that. One of the hardest things I know as a parent was you say, how was school today? And your student says, fine. Terrible,
what did you learn? What did
awful.
You learn?
Right.
Nothing.
So nothing. I learned nothing. So I'm willing to bet that they actually learned something. So we're going to try to be providing you with that. And also, I think we are talking about, and you'll hear more about this in the month of October and November, about a parent university that we're going to be offering in the late winter, early spring, so that parents can come in and hear more about the power of our words, hear more about our acceptance, belonging, community, and district level supports, equitable outcomes, hearing more about UDL, and actually experiencing some of our math and English language arts curriculum. So that will be coming up in the late winter, early spring.
And just to wrap that up, Laura, I'm glad you reminded me of that. I'm very excited about Parent University. It's been something I've been wanting to do for a really long time, and this feels like when we start to get into the meat of the school year, that where we were, where we are, where we're going, will start to mirror what Laura's talking about. You know, and it may be that I highlight certain grades. I certainly won't be able to do K to 12 every single time. But what you can start to look for is in those news bites that were more about pool testing, hand sanitizer, 6 feet apart last year, will be a summary of what I've presented here at school committee each month in a little bit more depth, with links to Power of Our Words, which is where we've started. And as we grow into things like UDL, how to set up your spaces at home, I will continue to also provide those vlogs along the way. So we'll have some universally designed ways. You can watch webinars, you can listen to me vlog, I will recommend readings, and then eventually you can come in and learn with us. So I'm excited about that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
School committee members, do you have any questions or comments regarding the presentation that you just saw?
It's kind of a COVID update. How did the vaccination clinic go? Was there any update on that?
We know that we had some number of people, and there were times when we looked out and we saw like two or three people in line. But we've been working with the company to try to find out what the exact number was that they had vaccinated. And they're coming back in 4 weeks because that's the length of this when the second vaccine has to come. They're coming back on September 21st. It's possible that by then we will know what the booster situation is and that we'll be able to schedule that as well.
Okay. So maybe like a final summary later on down the road or something.
I have numbers. Unfortunately, we haven't been able
to. No, that's fine.
They're a little busy, I think.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you.
Any other questions or comments? I'm used to the horseshoe.
I have to lean back.
All right. Okay, seeing that no more questions on that, we're going to go to the warrant article on file here. Jeff, I know that's your favorite.
Well, since Brian isn't here.
Yeah.
I would make a motion that we accept two payroll warrants totaling $1,085,756.79 and four accounts payable warrants totaling $1,085,011.01 for a grand total of $2,170,767.80.
Second.
Any discussion? Are you seeing no? We'll do a roll call vote. Is it going to start on the far end, Ralph?
Yes.
Jeff?
Yes.
Lacey?
Yes.
Marlena, yes. Faye?
Yes.
Okay. Under new business, I would like to have your question answered that you have. Did you still have a question?
I'm sorry.
I'm the one with the microphone. Do you have a question? No. Okay. I just wanted to. So, any new business from this board? Yes, Raph.
Go ahead. No, you had your hand up.
Just quickly, I forgot to announce this under liaisons, but hopefully towards the middle or the end of September, I believe myself, if not my colleague Lacey too, will be going to Swallow Union and doing a tour. We talked to Pete Meyerson in the fall, in May, and we agreed that probably the fall would be easier once everyone gets settled in, et cetera, et cetera. So once we finalize a date, we'll let you all know, and we will report back our endeavors at Swallow Union. And then after that, I believe it's Florence Roach. So we'll keep everyone updated. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm sorry.
Yeah?
My question is...
Can you come up to the microphone and ask so people at home can hear you?
Can't hear you.
I guess my question is, should the student opt out, have the option to opt out of optional COVID testing, the pool testing for athletics? Who has the authority to say they have to mask outside? I'd like to find that information somewhere, if I could, please.
So the authority, that's a compromise situation. And as I discussed with you on the phone today, so we can, just so for parents, I'm gonna do it as abroad. And if you wanna discuss your own situation further, I'm happy to talk to you about it. The requirement was that students had to be had to be pool tested. They had to participate in pool testing. Under some very limited circumstance where there is a medical or a, and I can't think of a medical reason why you couldn't use a Q-tip, but that's okay. There might also be some religious considerations. We have policies for that, and that is that the law says that if there is a sincerely held religious belief, and if there's documentation from a clergyman, from a parish, or your church, that documents that your religion is against that, and that's provided to us, then we have to make an accommodation. The accommodation is that that student has to be masked, because that's what is what.
Who's we? Who makes that law? Is it law?
It's not a law. Okay, it's a protocol. So that's our protocol, and we do that protocol because, as I explained to you and to several other parents who asked me questions. We actually already have had two athletes test positive. We have students who are playing close contact sports without masks this year, which was not the case last year. We are running sports this year that we could not run last year because they were close contact sports, such as football. We had two football games and a number of hockey games that we had to cancel last year because we had so many students with masks. That were positive. I feel like, especially with the Delta variant, I cannot take a chance with someone else's student, with someone else's child. I feel like I have a responsibility to every parent or family that sends students in this district to keep their child safe. So we made the decision after much consultation with the other principals and other superintendents in the Midwatch League.
Did the public have a vote in this? Who makes this decision?
Laura. Forgive me, I can't allow the back and forth conversation. You can definitely ask the question, which I believe she answered. It's a district policy. The community has a vote by electing the officials that hire the superintendent and in regards to that meaning. So if I understand that there's definitely going to be policies in this district that people don't agree with, there absolutely are. And I can guarantee you that there's on both ends, which we've been dealing with, the both end opinions about this, mask, not mask, testing, not testing. It's so we have to evaluate.
I'm just asking for clarification.
Right.
Is there any literature, policy. Any policy in writing that says who makes these decisions that I can be informed and maybe other people would like to be informed? So when we send our kids to school, we want to trust who's making these decisions for them?
We'll include it. I know that I have a kid in high school, so I saw, you know, the rules if my kid wants to play soccer and all that. So I know it was in an email that I at least got twice from Dr. Chesson. Mm-hmm. So
the
when
form
she
clearly out, states optional consent form.
And I've explained
that's deceiving. So I had 2 hours to figure that out, and I told my daughter, she's all set. I supplied the form that you asked for. No further action needed.
We discussed this, and I was clear.
I understand. You got the form. I got the form. There's. I don't know how many kids in the school.
Right. But
so clarification can be sent out to the district as a whole, and beyond that, obviously, if there's something else in regards to your student, I still implore you to please make a one-on-one appointment because. That's very important.
I was just invited here to ask the question. I'm just asking for clarification.
And,
so
yes,
thank you.
That's what I'm asking you, if you've gotten your clarification. your answer.
I'd like to see it in writing, please, if I could get the authority who makes these decisions. In writing,
the superintendent.
So she makes the decision that if you opt out and you supply proper form, they still have disciplinary actions and have to wear a mask outside for athletics.
I'm going to have the superintendent email everyone the actual policy.
I would appreciate that.
So that you have it in writing as well as she is verbally. Right. It is a district policy in regards to the it's not an MIAA from what I understand. It is Groton-Dunstable policy for athletics, which is an optional item for students to play versus a non-optional, like obviously being coming to school and learning in regards to that. So there is some leeway in regards for every administration and every district to have their own roles. And just as I can tell you, or their own policies, if you will, I can tell you from being the chair and being on a listserv with all the other chairs that are in the surrounding towns and are with the districts that we compare ourselves to, there are an array of policies out there right now because of COVID.
Yeah. And a 95 vaccination rate in the 16 to 19 year old age group at the high school. I just don't know where this is going to end, and I'm curious if other parents are wondering when this is going to end.
And perhaps as we get closer, hopefully we get to that vaccination percentage that where we can, you know, start returning to a new normal, if you will.
I would like that.
But so I guess the best thing that we can do at this point is to implore people to get vaccinated, because
these vaccinated people are becoming positive, though. We understand that, don't we?
I understand exactly from all of that. I do. But I also understand that even right now, Desi's magic number is 80%, and we can't do anything, period, until October 1st. Yes. And I feel like we've been doing the best that we can with this moving target for the last year and a half, and this is not going to be the last conversation that someone is disappointed. Mm-hmm. I'm disappointed in many things myself as a parent. Mm-hmm. I put on my school committee hat when I'm here, and I put on my parent hat when I'm at home and go through the same policies and escalation as you do. So I understand.
Thank you.
I do.
Thank you.
I think we're okay. Sorry.
I did have a quick question. So this form was not from us?
No, as I explained, the form comes from the testing company, which is the organization that the Department of Elementary and Secondary Education has contracted with. They're called CIC. They are also the people that did all the vaccinations. They did all the mass vax clinics across the state at Gillette, at Fenway, et cetera, et cetera. And they created a form, and it was a multi-use form for 2,000 schools. And as I stated, in some schools, they just sent it home to people. There are some schools that sent it home and said, you can't opt out. There are some school, you know, those would be charter schools and parochial schools that have more control over what decisions they can make. So this form was not the form we used last year. And it wasn't until very recently, maybe within the last 3 or 4 days, that people, I didn't even see the form. The form was created for us, and we were told we had to use the consent database by the state if we wanted the state to pick up the tab for our testing, and it's $10 per student per week to be tested in the pool testing. So that's a great expense, and so when someone says they're going to pick up that tab for you, we signed up for it.
So we were one of the districts that they just, here you go, sent it to.
It goes online. I had a link. Okay. I didn't even have a physical form. Gotcha. The only time I had a physical form was when I printed it off to ensure that students that came on Tuesday that did not have athletes, that did not have a form filled out, would have a physical form to take home to their parents to fill it out so that the kid could return to practice on Wednesday. Because as a parent of two athletes, the last thing I wanted to do was keep kids off the athletic field.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
The end of new business here.
I have.
Oh, Jeff. Yeah. Yes.
Sorry. So I was hoping not to do this, but we had passed a policy a few weeks ago regarding masks for the district, and the CDC guidance and our peer boards are following the CDC guidance, which is to wear masks during meetings, both audience and committee members or board members. And so I would like to make a motion that going forward, we require masks at school committee meetings for both the board and for the audience.
So Jeff, I asked you if I could put this on the agenda tonight, and you chose to say no. So if you want to discuss this.
You didn't ask me that.
You sent an email saying you prefer not to discuss it. Rafi, I'll have it on the next agenda, okay. September 22nd, and we'll discuss it then. That's when we'll be discussing it.
Point of information then, since he already made a motion, it's on the floor. So are you just rescinding it then?
Yeah.
Or are you just canceling it out so I know?
I'm going to be putting on the agenda on September 22nd.
Okay, so you're canceling it. Thank you.
I would entertain a motion to adjourn. Actually, I don't have to entertain a motion to adjourn.
You can just call me adjourn.
I just want to make a suggestion for the buses. My son has been taking the bus.
Can you come to the microphone?
Yes, I can. I'm pretty loud, so I didn't think it would be a problem.
Just for our viewers at home.
No problem. So my son has been taking the bus. He's high school, so he gets in butt crack early. And the problem is they're the first kids to get on the bus. So if the windows have been open and it's been raining, the seats are sopping wet. Now the students are getting to school wet and cold, which is not a good solution. So if you could make a suggestion to the bus companies to come up to provide something or come up with a solution to get the seats dry. Otherwise, our students are arriving at school sopping wet, taking public or school transportation.
I'll bring that to their attention.
I would appreciate it.
Thank you.
I would adjourn the September 8th meeting.